talked about the ways in which healthy soil depends on living plants. Farmers who build healthy soil successfully know that they have to keep living plants in the ground as many days of the year as possible. And during non-cash crop periods, this means planting and managing cover crops. Don't think of cover crops as an off-season expense whose only job is to control erosion. Cover crops are an asset.
There's a lot more benefits to a cover crop than just soil erosion, because it increases the health of the soil, and I'm beginning to build organic matter in the top 1 inch of my soil. And you got organic matter to absorb it rapidly, you're going to conserve your moisture, and if it's in a non-irrigated situation, that moisture can get you through a 2 to 3 week drought. Also, cover crops will scavenge nitrogen that was left from the previous crop, whereas in a conventional system, they will probably be lost.
Cover crops are a highly valuable tool at the time you start on a program to reduce tillage on your fields. Depleted soil that's been intensively tilled badly needs live plants in the ground as many days of the year as possible. Planting cover crops enables you to build soil much faster than if you just rely on surface residue.
The old saying, land was meant to be covered, soil was meant to be covered, that rings true in this case. So if your cover crop is putting the nutrients back into the soil, and then when you terminate them, you got the residue there to hold your moisture and so forth, you know, there's no way you can lose on that.
It's important for you to understand that effective cover crops require planning, investment, and active management.
It took me quite a few years to get to the point where I am now. You can't do it overnight. But if you keep doing it, it will build up and be worth it to you.
Think about selecting cover crops that are different from your cash crops.
We found that rye has turned out to be our best choice. But the thing that we like the most about it is this biomass that it produces. We can get as much as 6 tons of biomass per acre. A lot of our farmers, and they like to say the more the better. But another good thing about rye is it has the most extensive root system. It acts as a plow itself.
This is a naturally reseeded field of Italian ryegrass and some wild oats. It's a very cheap cover crop because I don't have to plant it. It does not have the above ground biomass that rye does, but below ground the root system is much, much larger, and then it can scavenge nutrients very well and also penetrate the soil, and hopefully it can even grow through our hard pan. And if this is the case, then we may be able to eliminate a subsoiler in future years and only plant no-till straight into the ryegrass.
Many farmers plant legumes as part of their cover crop mixtures. Legumes have the added ability to fix atmospheric nitrogen.
In this particular field here, this is the second year of the crimson clover, and this crop will start coming up again, and we don't have the added expense of coming in and putting in a cover crop every year where we have got this clover established. We're fixing up to 125 to 150 pounds of nitrogen that this clover cover crop is fixing, and about half of that being readily available the next spring, summer growing season. When we're going to terminate this cover crop, it's physiologically mature, and so it's built up the lignans in it, and this clover cover crop won't go away real fast. And you can see when it does fall down, you get a complete coverage of the soil. You know, the only place we're really going to have open in a good stand of clover is where we come through with our strip till rig, open up a little area, put the seed in, and close it back up.
Cover crops are also a great tool for suppressing weeds.
With a heavy cover crop such as rye that you allow to get 6 feet tall, and then I roll it down prior to planting, and it's a mat on the soil surface, and pigweed has a very tough time getting through that mat.
The cover crop outcompetes the weeds that normally appear in off-season fields. Weeds lose the advantage they enjoy during the fallow period.
Probably our main problem would be our wild radish. If we have a wild radish problem, we go into that field knowing that first year that we're just going to live with it, and we're going to terminate that wild radish when we terminate this clover. But what we find in the subsequent year or the following year is that this clover starts germinating, and it's beating up the wild radish, which has been our main weed or competitor in it. And when I say beating it up, it's germinating, growing, and then it pretty much just shades out the wild turnips. And over a 3 or 4 year period, clover becomes the dominant plant species this time of year.